Hello and welcome to the episode 53 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Today's highlights include a discussion of the origin of Northern songs, the Fab's 1964 return from the United States, and some recording sessions. On the 22nd of February 1961, the Beatles, with Pete Best on drums, performed in two venues in Liverpool. For the 12th time, they were on the stage of the Aintree Institute for another BK Promotions event that paid them £7.02, about £140 in 2020 money. Then, the lads were driven by Neil Aspinall to the Hambleton Hall, this time for an event put together by Wally Hill and Vic Cannon, two local promoters. In 1963, after the announcement to the Cavern Club audience detailed in episode 50 of What a Fab Day, Please Please Me officially became the first Beatles single to reach number one on the New Musical Express weekly sales chart, sharing the top spot with Frank Ifield's The Wayward Wind. But this was not the only important development of the day. Today, publisher Dick James suggested to the Beatles manager Brian Epstein to create a company with John Lennon and Paul McCartney. According to James, this company, called Northern Songs, could have earned the two composers more money and more control than any other publishing contract. Epstein proposed the deal to Lennon and McCartney, who agreed and signed the contract without even reading it. And this is where problems started. In their inexperience, John and Paul thought that they would have owned the whole company, while in fact, they were offered 20% of the ownership each, with Epstein getting 10% and James and his partner Silver the remaining 50%. Along the years, there have been a number of claims, especially from Paul McCartney, that James had offered some kind of slave contract to the two young composers. But, with all due respect to Sir Paul, I think anyone claiming that might be underestimating the circumstances of the deal. For a start, in the early 1960s, having the composers owning even part of their publishing was hardly the norm, even for established composers that have proven their worth many times over. Just a few years earlier, in the 1950s, the norm was for rock and roll composers to sell their rights to publishers for a flat sum of money. Little Richard, for example, sold the rights for his Tutti Frutti for $50. This meant that the publisher would keep earning money in case of a successful song, while the writer would not see a single penny. By the early 1960s, the situation had got a little better, but the idea of forming a joint venture with two unknown composers from Liverpool, giving them some control on their rights, when James had to do much of the work to place their songs, was, again, far from standard treatment and relatively generous. It was only a good 10 to 15 years later that the current standard contract of music publishing, giving the composers a 75% share of the earning, became the accepted norm. Perhaps John and Paul could have got a better deal, but keep in mind that, in February 1963, not even they knew that they would become The Beatles, all capital letters. A world sensation that made music history, and a duo of composers whose songs would sell themselves. In 1964, for example, John Lennon still admitted in an interview that, "I know this thing can't last, I'm saving the money." And, in fairness to James himself, he did his job and did push for opportunities for the Beatles and for John's and Paul's compositions. The Beatles' debut on Thank Your Lucky Stars, an incredible coup for the advancement of their career, happened thanks to Dick James, as detailed in episode 13 of What a Fab Day. On the live concert front, the band returned to the Oasis Club in Manchester for an evening concert. On this date in 1964, the Beatles landed in London at 8:10 a.m. As customary, the band gave a press conference in the Kingsford Smith suite of the airport. Images of their landing with an accompanying interview were included in BBC's Grandstand program, aired between 1 p.m. and 5:15 p.m. Curiously, Grandstand was a program normally dealing with sport events, and the item covering the Beatles' return was 13 minutes 23 seconds long, a major slot. Naturally, ITV covered the band's return too, and Pathé News put together a brief report called Beatles Welcome Home to be distributed in cinemas. In addition, BBC Radio's Saturday Club featured a 4-minute exclusive interview with the lads, followed by a song request by George Harrison's mother, Shop Around by The Miracles. Other radios had their hosts covering the return in their news programs. Brian Epstein was immediately flooded with requests for a prompt return to the States, but in his typical fashion, he refused to consider any possibility at the moment. He was wary of overexposure, and he was aware that other markets and offers awaited for the Beatles in London. Concerts in Denmark, Netherlands, Australia, Hong Kong, demands for another UK tour. The band would return to the United States only in August. At night, Paul McCartney went to see his girlfriend Jane Asher acting in Christopher Marlowe's The Jew of Malta in Canterbury. If you're liking the series, please visit www.simonmas.com/support and be fab! Not only even a small donation can help me putting more work on giving you the highest quality product, but you can share this podcast with your friends so that more people become aware of it. I also love comments too. Moving to the 22nd of February 1965, the Beatles left London on a Boeing 707 to the Bahamas, settling in New Providence at the Balmoral Club to start the shooting for their new film, still untitled at the time. Their departure was greeted by 1,400 fans. In 1967, the Beatles spent a 7 p.m. to 3:45 a.m. session at the EMI Studios trying and completing the coda of A Day in the Life. John felt that the initial idea of the Hammond Choir wasn't powerful enough to supply a memorable ending. So, during this session, John, Paul, Ringo, and their assistant Mal Evans sat at three grand pianos recording the sound of a big E major chord. This took 9 takes to accomplish, since the players had to be in perfect unison. Onto this 9th take, they overdubbed 3 more E major chords while George Martin complemented the sound, playing the same chord on an harmonium. This chord lasted 53 seconds and, with some editing, it became the perfect ending for the song and the Sgt. Pepper's album as a whole. The session was rounded up with the production of various mono and stereo mixes and with a sound experiment. Ringo Starr was the center of anything, a 22-minute 10-second piece consisting of drum beats, tambourine and congas. The song was never released, and according to Beatles historian Mark Lewson, not even a rough mix was ever attempted. Moving on to 1969, we find the Beatles and Billy Preston at the Trident Studios in London between 8 p.m. and 5 a.m. to work on I Want You, She's So Heavy. They recorded 35 takes with a guide vocal. This, theoretically, started the work on the Beatles' final sessions as a band, those producing Abbey Road. But that story will have to wait another bit to start. Finally, in 1970, another Billy Martin session took place at EMI Studios between noon and 10 p.m. As you might recall, Paul McCartney had personally booked a number of sessions with that pseudonym in the early days of 1970. He intended to keep his solo project secret to everyone at Apple, including his bandmates. Although this had to be just another mixing session, Paul decided to record 2 more songs for the album, Every Night and Maybe I'm Amazed. He started and completed the songs Today, recording voice, 3 acoustic guitars, bass and drums for every night, and voice backing vocals with Linda McCartney, piano, lead and rhythm guitar, organ, bass and drums for Maybe I'm Amazed. He completed the session with a stereo mix of the two titles and of That Would Be Something and Valentine Day. This concludes this episode of What a Fab Day. In the episode description, among other things, you will find a link to the interview the Beatles gave to BBC's Grand Stand for their 1964 return, if you want to give it a view. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation.
Simon Mas, music you love.